Praveen, you know, you've been tracking terror outfits operating out of Pakistan for years now. To start with, what do you make of the response that's come in from India? A very measured statement being put out by the Foreign Secretary saying that this was a non-military preemptive strike, basis credible information that more attacks were being planned.
That's right, a very measured statement, and also bears out what is publicly available. The Jaish-e-Mohammed had been advertising quite publicly in its newspapers and on its websites that it was holding sessions to recruit new cadre running right through February and early March. We'd carried some of those advertisements in First Post last issue, in fact, and was issuing public threats on social media about carrying out further acts of terror in Jammu and Kashmir. What the foreign ministry's statement essentially says is that, look, we're not retaliating for Pulwama. We're not doing some sort of, you know, revenge attack here. Yeah. There is credible information that the Jaish-e-Mohammed is carrying out attacks. We are preventing those attacks. This camp, by the way, is a very well-known one. It's featured in a number of criminal prosecutions, including criminal prosecutions in the United States of America. So no secret here about this camp. Its activities. We'll of course get to know the precise casualty toll as the days go by.
You're absolutely right. India making that very clear distinction that this is not a retaliatory measure because of the Pulwama attacks, but this is basis credible information that future attacks were being planned on Indian soil. You also talked about the strategic importance of going after this specific terror camp, the largest JEM camp operating in Balkot. Praveen, you know, there's been a lot of confusion on Balkot since morning, basis the tweets that were put out by the Pakistan Army, and of course now we've known from the Foreign Secretary. For the benefit of our viewers, if you can explain the strategic importance of this camp in Balakot.
Well, Balakot, as you know, there are two Balakots. There's one, and the reason perhaps confusion happened is that people were looking up the names on Google. There's one which is a little village in Poonch on the Indian side of the line of control, and that's not relevant to this story. The other place called Balakot is the Jaish-e-Mohammed's largest, most historic camp. In fact, in his book Fathul Jawad, which is a disquisition on the jihadist verses in the Quran, Masood Azhar talks about his sentimental attachment to this particular place. He talks about its historic relevance in a jihad that took place in 1831 in the Sikh Empire and how that story inspired him to set up the Jaish-e-Mohammed in the first place. We know from satellite imagery that it's quite a large place at a specific point called Jabba Top, which is sort of halfway between Balakot and Mansehra. Both these towns in the province of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa, they're not actually in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir. They're in Pakistan proper. But this camp has been running for years. It's trained hundreds, if not thousands, of fighters. In interrogation after interrogation, both in the United Kingdom, in the United States, and in India, terrorists have revealed they were trained there. It's been a place of great sort of regional and global threat. And the decision to target it quite clearly taken because of intelligence reports that there was this large assembly of under-training terrorists at that location. I'm guessing also that the fact that it's quite a distance from both towns and therefore the risk of civilian casualties would have been minimal would also have weighed on the minds of planners. I mean, the last thing India would have wanted at a time like this is to accidentally inflict large amounts of civilian collateral damage.
Oh, absolutely. And that was also emphasized there by the Foreign Secretary in his briefing that India was very mindful of the fact that there should not be collateral damage or civilian casualties. And that is the point that Praveen is also highlighting. Praveen, you know, with the fact that this is for the very first time that air operations, that the Indian Air Force has been activated to conduct this strike, also seems to very clearly articulate a change in our policy for the future.
Absolutely, and this has enormous strategic consequences. Quite frankly, I think India, Pakistan, and the entire world are slightly in uncharted waters here, and this is why. two Indian prime ministers had exactly the same option in the past. Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee after the attack on Parliament and Prime Minister Manmohan Singh after 2611. And both of them essentially thought that the risk of this escalating into a conventional conflict, which could end up inflicting severe harm on Pakistan, but also harm on India's economic prospects, outweighed the potential benefits of such a strike. Now, you can argue about the rights and wrongs of their decision, but that was their thinking.
Yeah.
Pakistan, I mean, now the ball is in Pakistan's court, as it were, and it has essentially three options. The first, at the risk of being a little crude, is to suck it up. It could decide that, you know, they have an IMF bailout they're struggling to secure. They're grey-listed in the FATF and fighting to avoid blacklisting. And their budget deficit is completely out of control. They could just decide that, look, the costs of any retaliatory action against India would inflict far larger costs on the Pakistan economy, and they can't afford it, so we should just let this go. The second option is that they could step it up. Now, after the surgical strikes in 2016, they actually stepped up the level of violence in Kashmir through their proxies, like the Jaish-e-Mohammed and the Lashkar-e-Taiba. And as a result, in 2017 and 18, we actually ended up with more soldiers dead than we did the year before the surgical strikes. They could choose to do that, but with the fear that they're going to end up getting bombed again at each stage. So this changes the game a little bit, I mean, quite substantially. The third option, which I've seen some Pakistani military officers advocating in closed WhatsApp groups of Pakistani military officers, is to totally ratchet up the stakes and go for a conventional conflict in the hope that the United States and China will then step in and bail them out of what is a really ugly situation. Now, I'm sure that very smart people in Islamabad are thinking about these options, just as very smart people in the Indian government are thinking about these options. But like I said, we're in uncharted waters here. There is no precedent in the history of warfare for two nuclear-armed states to be engaged in an eyeball-to-eyeball confrontation like this. We just don't know how this is going to play out. We'll just have to watch very, very carefully.
Absolutely, you're right that it, you know, we do need to exercise caution while speculating about the road ahead. But just on the issue of escalation and on the basis of the evidence that we have so far, and you highlighted several of those issues, the problems that Pakistan is facing domestically with the IMF bailout, being grey-listed for the FATF, and of course its own capabilities when it comes to military power. But separately, you know, the international condemnation has been swift and strong, asking Pakistan to act against terror outfits. We are given to understand that the Ministry of External Affairs has called for an envoys for a meeting here in India. So given this context, is an escalation less likely today?
I think Pakistan would be extremely ill-advised, given the state of its economy, to ratchet things up. Quite simply, their economy is in tatters, and war is an expensive business. Clausewitz, one of the great military theorists of the 19th century, said that wars aren't fought with soldiers, they really fought with cash. And he's quite right. And the, you know, Pakistan is broke. If it ends up in a conflict, it will have asymmetric consequences for their growth. But we must remember that decisions to go to war aren't always driven by cold reason. They're also driven by politics. Remember, Imran Khan humiliated Nawaz Sharif over the penetration of Pakistani airspace when the US strikes took place against Osama bin Laden in Abbottabad. And I'm guessing that both former Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif and Asif Ali Zardari will be looking to repay the compliment. The Pakistani armed forces themselves will be facing stringent criticism in coming days over how the Indian Air Force managed so successfully to penetrate Pakistani airspace and leave even before the Pakistanis could scramble their air defenses. I think it's worth being cognizant of the fact that sometimes bad decisions are taken by politicians under pressure. Now, is this going to happen? I don't know. You're entirely right about international pressure, by the way. I think the Americans have made very clear that their patience with Pakistani inaction against terrorists is at an end. President Donald Trump, a couple of days ago, I think almost gave a giveaway tweet where he said, I understand the Indians are planning something very strong. And sadly, Imran Khan either wasn't listening or didn't get the message. But the world's been telling them that, look, you're leaving India with no options other than to hit you. Having said that, the Pakistanis are going to have to do something. We saw what they did after 2016, which is to step it up for India within Kashmir using their jihadi proxies. Maybe they'll do that again. We don't know. Mm-hmm. But then again, I think really what's happened here is that India's drawn a line in the sand saying, you cross this line and there will be consequences. Where that takes us is, you know, is anybody's guess. But my personal feeling is that the Pakistanis are going to try to ride this out by saying nothing happened, nothing important happened anyway. Let's just pretend everything is fine and move on.
Well, that is exactly right, because what Praveen is saying is what we've seen, the Pakistani response, at least if you look at what the Pakistani DGPR has been tweeting since morning, is that nothing has virtually happened, that this was a failed attempt on the part of the Indian Air Force. That's been the narrative that the Pakistani side has been pushing. Praveen, in light of those comments that have come in through the morning from Pakistan, in a sense, would you see that as an indication of trying to de-escalate, saying that, look, nothing's happened? That's their address to the domestic
Absolutely.
Constituency, isn't
it? That is addressed to their domestic constituency. And I think the Pakistan army, or at least saner people within it, understand that there are no good options for them. There's no jihad training camps they can hit over here. They don't want to get locked in a cycle of tit-for-tat retaliation, which will damage their economy more than it will damage India's. They don't want to target the Indian army knowing that they will get disproportionately targeted back. Having said that, Shireen, we live in strange times where the social media is extremely active, where politicians are acutely sensitive to what's being said about them.
Yes.
Where, you know, the Pakistan army, I understand from local residents, has cordoned off the area. It's not even letting police in. But we know that realistically, in coming days, little bits of video of the dead and injured will emerge on people's WhatsApp feeds. There will be nationalist outrage. It's going to be a challenge for Imran Khan to manage this. And as a young and inexperienced politician, exactly how he pulls it off, I wouldn't bet money on. So we do have to watch this very, very closely. Having said that, there's a little bit of history that I think is important for Indian listeners, particularly people in business and finance. So in 2001, Prime Minister Atal Bihari Vajpayee, in response to the attack on Parliament, launched what was the largest military mobilization since the Second World War anywhere in the world and pushed our troops forward. Now, it was extremely expensive for the Indian Army. We lost more soldiers in that mobilization than we did during the Kargil War. We didn't go to war, but what we know is that from 2004, Pakistan backed off in Kashmir. And there's a fascinating story to do with this, which one of General Musharraf's closest confidants, General Moinuddin Haider, once said in an interview. And what he basically said was that, look, you know, this military crisis with India can go on forever. The difference is that India can afford it. Maybe it'll knock a percent or half a percent off their GDP. We cannot afford it. The handful of investors we have, the little bit of capital we get back from, the little bit of investment we get from non-resident Pakistanis, that disappears when there's a crisis like this. Things are bad enough for us. We simply can't afford this crisis. And from 2003, for 10 years running, Pakistan scaled down the jihad in Kashmir to zero. I suspect there are going to be a lot of people from Pakistan's financial community, from its business community, telling Imran Khan that, look, just look at your budget deficit figures, look at your balance of payment situation. For God's sake, don't destroy our economy chasing after some, you know, pyrrhic sense of victory or pyrrhic sense of revenge, rather. I suspect the Pakistani business community is going to be lobbying their prime minister and their armed forces very, very hard to just back off. And I suspect those voices will prevail, because at the end of the day, money does talk.
Oh, absolutely. Money does talk. Praveen Swamy, thanks very much for joining us and giving us not just a perspective on the current developments, but also a historical perspective on the choices before both India and Pakistan. As Praveen was pointing out, you don't finally know the decision that Pakistan will take, perhaps to address its domestic constituencies, but it is not something that Pakistan, a full-fledged war is not something that Pakistan can afford at this point in time, given the precarious nature of its economy. As they say, capital is a coward, it goes where it feels safe, and capital is what Pakistan needs today. But one will have to see how this plays out.